Welcome to Columbia Law School. My name is Kendall Thomas. I'm a member of the faculty here. I'm the director of the Center for the Study of Law and Culture. I'm very happy to welcome you this evening for a number of reasons. The first reason is because this is the Paul Robeson Lecture and an opportunity to remember and celebrate one of Columbia Law School's most esteemed and accomplished graduates, Paul Robeson, who graduated from Columbia Law School in 1923. He was an artist, an activist, and a towering figure in the global struggle for the freedom of oppressed peoples. And it is indeed an honor simply to be able to stand here and invoke his name. The son of a runaway slave who achieved a level of acclaim and recognition, not only for himself as an individual, but for his people. And he stands, I think, today and still as a model to which all of those of us who believe in freedom should aspire. The second reason I stand here is because the person I'm about to introduce to you is someone I've been waiting to introduce for a year. She was scheduled to be the speaker last year for the Robeson Lecture, and as those of you who were in New York City or trying to get to New York City around this time last year will recall, we were experiencing almost as much in the way of bad weather as our comrades to the north in Boston seem to be going through right now. And my heart sank when the university announced the very day, the afternoon of the lecture, that the university was shutting down because the weather was so awful. My heart skipped a beat earlier today when I looked out the window and I saw snow. And I thought, that is not going to happen this year. Not only because of my personal investment in the success of this evening's event, but because of the admiration and the esteem I hold for the person you are about to hear. May I still call you Professor? You Professor Sherrilyn Ifill. Professor Ifill is a member of the Faculty of Law at the University of Maryland Law School, and I had the privilege of getting to know her as a colleague a few years ago when I visited at Maryland. She's on leave from that institution and is doing fine work as the seventh president and the Director-Counsel of the NAACP Legal Defense and Education Fund. Ms. Ifill is a longtime member of the LDF family. After her graduation from law school, she served first as a fellow at the American Civil Liberties Union and then worked for 5 years as an assistant counsel in the LDF's New York office. She litigated voting rights cases and thus is an expert from her practice experience with respect to one of the issues about which she'll be speaking to us this evening. Among her successful litigation was the landmark voting rights case, Houston Lawyers Association v. Attorney General of Texas, in which the Supreme Court held that judicial elections are covered by the provisions of Section 2 of the Voting Rights Act. As I mentioned earlier, Professor Ifill joined the faculty at the University of Maryland Law School in 1993, where she taught civil procedure, constitutional law, and a variety of seminars while continuing to litigate and consult on a broad and diverse range of civil rights cases. Professor Ifill launched several innovative legal offerings at Maryland Law School, including the Environmental Justice course, in which students represented rural communities in Maryland, and one of the first legal clinics in the nation focused on removing legal barriers to formerly incarcerated persons seeking to responsibly reenter society. And from her base in Baltimore at the University of Maryland, Sherrilyn Ifill emerged very quickly as a highly regarded national civil rights strategist and as a public intellectual whose writings and speaking engagements and media appearances enriched and continue to enrich the public debate about a broad range of political and civil rights issues. She is the author of an extraordinary book to which I want to recommend all of you to put on your reading lists, On the Courthouse Lawn, Confronting the Legacy of Lynching in the 21st Century, a book in which she reflects and a book which reflects her lifelong engagement in an analysis of issues of race and American public life. She is the immediate past chair of the Board of U.S. Programs at the Open Society Institute and a graduate of Vassar College and from our sister law school to the South, New York University School of Law. She's come to talk to us this evening about race, rights, and the future of American democracy, a topic which, given the events in this country of the past few months, is unquestionably of some urgency. And I am sure that she will have sharp and enlightening and illuminating things to say about race, rights, and American democracy at this peculiar juncture in our common life. So please join me in welcoming to the podium Sherrilyn Ifill.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Thomas, and thanks to all of you for coming. Thank you to Columbia Law School for persevering and getting me here this year, to Dean Lester in her absence, and to all of the faculty members who were able to come and students. You know that the relationship between Columbia Law School and LDF is a very close one, not the least of which because our second Director-Counsel, Jack Greenberg, is a Columbia alum and later professor, still professor, and of course, Ted Shaw, who most recently was here on the faculty and now is at University of North Carolina. And of course, professors at Columbia played a really important role as advisors to LDF and have played an important role as advisors to LDF for our entire history. We turned 75 in March and we'll be kicking off our anniversary. But for that entire 75-year period, we have collaborated with faculty members and students at Columbia Law School as we have strategized and developed our work and our response to the civil rights issues of the day. So I also want to thank our research assistant, Chris Lamott, who's here in the front row, who helps prepare me for my events and who prepared this set of materials for you. If you didn't pick up a copy, you can go to our website, www.naacpldf.org, and if you go to the link for this event, you can review all of the materials and some additional ones that are not in this packet. And I commend them to you, first to those of you who are getting CLE credit, but I also commend them to you because almost everything I'm going to talk about today is documented somewhere in those materials. And I think we have to really ground ourselves in understanding this moment that we're in ways that are not just rhetorical, but that are based in fact and scholarship. And so I hope you'll take the time to look at some of those materials. So this is an important year for us at LDF. As I said, it's our 75th year. And I'm something of a legal historian, so it's perfect for me because I love digging through old documents, particularly about the history of race and law in this country. And LDF has been such an important part of that. And so I enjoy going through our history and understanding it. But I also enjoy it because it's quite inspirational for me. It shows me what really can emerge and what you can accomplish with a group of lawyers and a group of academics and a group of activists who together decided to envision something about the world that didn't exist. They made it up in their own heads, and then they created it out of their own passion and out of their own commitment and out of the words of the very documents that excluded them. And so I find tremendous inspiration in looking at LDF's history. And I think that it's important because the work that we do at LDF really is what I have been calling democracy maintenance work. By that I mean that civil rights work is not the work of those who are engaged in some niche activity that is relevant only to black people or gay people or women or Latino people. But that instead, those of us who have committed our lives to civil rights law are in the business of democracy maintenance. We check the foundation of this country. We find out when there are cracks and fissures. We look for answers and for solutions. We tell the truth about the state of our democracy. And we do it by looking at the conditions of those who are most marginalized, those who are pushed to the bottom and to the edges. And to be honest, what we found in this country very often is that the state and the soundness of our democracy is in peril. And I find this today. Now, when I say that, it's not to say that we haven't made enormous progress in many areas. My life, and probably the life of many people in this room, is a testament to that progress. And much of that progress has been pushed and shaped by LDF, I'm proud to say. There's almost no room that I enter in this country that has not in some way been created by the work of LDF, including this room. Without LDF's work, it wouldn't look like this, wouldn't feel like this. And we have that to be proud of. Last year was the 60th anniversary of Brown versus Board of Education, the 50th anniversary of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, the 50th anniversary of Freedom Summer. And those anniversaries presented unique challenges for those of us engaged in civil rights work. And I have to admit, I've been particularly impatient with those who've questioned the significance of some of those milestones, of Brown, for example. Far too often, the questioner has been someone sitting in an endowed chair or at a university or a columnist for a magazine that would never have hired them but for Brown. And so that's part of my impatience. But the other part of it is that I think it's okay to be able to do two things at once, to recognize that we have made progress and also to recognize that we have a very serious battle ahead of us today. So I like to look at that history and to get encouraged by that history, but I also am deeply pragmatic and I am very attracted to the truth. And the truth is that we are in a deeply perilous moment in our democracy in this country. In fact, I believe that the two issues that have wrapped so many of us in the African-American community and in other communities over the last year, voting rights and police violence against unarmed African Americans, are symptomatic of a weakness that goes to the very foundation of our democracy and that constitutes an existential threat to the vitality of our democracy. And this is a threat for which we as lawyers, whether we're civil rights lawyers or not, must take responsibility. Because of course, at the core of the threat is racism, ongoing, toxic, unresolved racism. But the means through which this poison is being so powerfully deployed is in the deliberate effort to inhibit African Americans from fully participating in the political process through voter suppression and the taking of innocent African American life by law enforcement officials. And this is creating an existential problem because the rule of law is now a subject of deep debate and, frankly, skepticism by too many in this country. And we, those of us who took an oath to uphold the rule of law, who've devoted our lives to it, who know that it lies at the very cornerstone of our democracy, must wake up and take responsibility for the deepening of this skepticism. One of the almost subversive aspects of being a civil rights lawyer, especially for people like our first Director-Counsel, Thurgood Marshall, and his mentor, Charles Hamilton Houston, and Robert Carter, and Constance Baker Motley, was their commitment to the rule of law, even at the time that the law did not recognize them and their full right as citizens. They believed in the rule of law as a means to change, not the only means, of course, but as a critically important means, and they were right. But their premise is now under challenge. Because when Mike Brown and Eric Garner and Ezell Ford and Kajemi Powell and John Crawford and Tamir Rice and Akai Gurley, and those are just a few, unarmed African-American men killed by law enforcement. And to date, no one has been held accountable. No one. No one has lost their job. Akai Gurley was just recently indicted, but we've seen that before. So there was the taking of innocent life by the state with no accountability. When that happens, our own credibility as lawyers and as defenders of the rule of law is under threat. When a federal judge in Texas can find, as happened last October, that the state of Texas intentionally sought to keep minority voters from participating in the political process with its new voter ID law. That's the voter ID law that no longer permitted our clients, students at predominantly black universities in Texas, from using their state university ID to vote, but does allow you to use a concealed gun carry permit to vote. When a federal judge can find that that law was designed, created, enacted intentionally to discriminate against minority voters, but the Supreme Court can stay that decision and determine that the 2014 election can proceed nevertheless, under those new restrictions, there are legitimate questions about the rule of law and its efficacy in addressing injustice and inequality. Our legitimacy, our ability to encourage you, law students, as well as those in the communities we represent to believe in the rule of law, depends on our ability to show that it works. That it's not just a series of delays and obfuscations and pretty words. I know that for many of you, the issue of police violence against unarmed African Americans and the impunity for these killings has resonated powerfully. And it has resonated powerfully for us in LDF as well. We take very seriously the charge of the history I just described. We take very, very seriously the rule of law. We take very seriously the pain of families and communities who've suffered these losses. And we face very seriously what these events say about who we are as a country. And so we've thought through some ways that we're addressing it. But I want to begin by making sure that we're very clear that this is not a new problem. It so happens earlier this year that I was booked to speak in St. Louis a month after Mike Brown was killed. And I went, and when I went, I did a radio show before my talk. And during the radio show, the host asked me, why are we seeing this rash of police killings? And maybe some of you are asking the same question. What's happening? Why are we seeing this rash of police killings? And I answered him in a way that I'll answer you, which is that it's not new. What you mean is that you are seeing it, largely because we now have cell phone videos, which have taken away, at least in some instances, the deniability, but certainly not all. We have social media. I learned about Mike Brown's killing about an hour after he was killed on Twitter, and then began to follow it and followed it for 4 days until it finally showed up on mainstream media, I think on the Tuesday after his death. And so we can disseminate that information more quickly among one another. But it's not new. And so I told the host that my first exposure to the issue of law enforcement killing of unarmed African Americans happened when I was 10, here in New York, where I grew up. And when I was 10, a police officer killed a young boy. And the incident was powerful because I was 10 and the boy was 10. And I told the radio host in St. Louis, I said, you know, I don't remember his name, but I've always remembered that the officer's name was Shay. And I remember what the newspaper looked like. And I remember us talking about it at the bus stop. And I remember our parents talking about it. And I remember that he got off. You got it. So I talked about how I was shaped. That was my first exposure. When I got back to my hotel room, those of you who may follow me know that I'm kind of a Twitter freak, right? So you should follow me on Twitter. And I got back to my hotel room, and someone had tweeted me and said, I found the story, and sent me a link to a newspaper article. And in fact, I was right. The officer's name was Shay. And the boy's name was Clifford Glover. He was walking with his father on a Saturday morning. And these officers rolled up in a car, not a marked car, plain clothes, began to chase them with a gun, shot the boy, and began to exult. We got him. And only stopped exulting when the precinct commander came and said, couldn't you see he was a kid? And they said, oh, they thought he was a robbery suspect. Officer Shay was also indicted. He was acquitted, thus got off. But I'm 52. So we're now talking about an incident that happened 42 years ago. Paul Robeson, for whom this extraordinary lecture series is named, talked in 1950 about the weeping mothers of Harlem whose sons were victims of the latest incident of police brutality. So this has been an ongoing issue. And so this summer when Tamir Rice was killed in Cleveland, 12-year-old Tamir Rice, I started thinking about what children were being shaped as I was shaped by the death of Clifford Glover. And for me, what this means is we have to make a decision that enough is enough. We have to make a decision that we want to make a change. And we have to be committed ferociously to that decision. Because what needs to change are two things. One, the culture of policing. And two, what we think about the merit and the value of black life. So let's start with the culture of policing. I'm sure you've heard that a lot, people talking about the culture of policing. I think it's important that we acknowledge it as culture. Culture is deeply embedded. It doesn't change because of one lawsuit. I think particularly when we think about policing is a profession in this country that is largely embedded in families. So your dad was a police officer and your uncle was a police officer and your mom's a prosecutor, that there's kind of a law enforcement family. And that's relevant because what you hear at home about how you are to execute your job is in some ways as important to you and in some instances more important than what you hear down in the training room. So we have to talk about this culture and how do we unearth this culture of policing. I think that we're in a moment when we can make this change. It's the moment because, as I said, we've now got the cell phone videos, and so we can see, and I'm, again, not suggesting that's the panacea, because we are still, because of our kind of embedded stories about race, still conditioned to see things that are there and not see other things that are in plain sight. But I also think it's the time to make this change, because there are other societal forces happening that are forcing our hand. One of them is the proliferation of guns in our society. Since the Supreme Court's decision striking down restrictions on handgun possession, the sunset on the assault ban's weapon, gun sales have risen dramatically, and when you add in the illegal sale of guns and new open carry and concealed laws, police officers in many states and cities actually have a legitimate fear that anyone they pull over or encounter may be packing. I was actually quite astonished in the midst of all of the Ferguson discussion in August and September that in early September in Missouri passed a new gun carry law that I think permits teachers and administrators to carry guns, and also reduced the age for the concealed gun carry permit from 21 to 19. So there's some real fear that we actually have to acknowledge that a lot of people are carrying guns. Thirdly, now's the time, because they really are, some senior police officers and police chiefs and law enforcement scholars around the country who are thoughtful and sincerely engaged with issues of training and rejecting broken windows policing and pushing for community policing. And some of them I tussle with, I don't agree with them on everything, but some of these leaders are at least attempting to engage legitimate critiques of police practices, believe in the professionalization of policing, and are scholars in their own right in the field who have something to bring to the table about how we change policing. And so there's some space for dialogue and experimentation and change. And lastly, we're in this moment because young people have become engaged in this issue like never before. And young people have always played a critical role in forcing our hand. I was just at a briefing in DC on a report we did about African American girls, and I was talking about the way in which Barbara Johns, a 16-year-old high school student in Virginia, forced us to speed up the filing of our Brown cases by leading a walkout of students in her segregated high school in Prince Edward County, Virginia. And so I'm always encouraged by the role that young people play in just pushing in ways that we need. I think the turning point was the killing of Trayvon Martin, who was not killed by a police officer, but was killed by somebody who thought maybe he was a police officer. And his death and the failure to hold George Zimmerman accountable struck a deep chord among young people, as did the challenge, an ongoing challenge, to New York City stop and frisk practices. And so beginning with the Dream Defenders and including the Million Hoodies campaign and Millennial AU and so many others began organizing themselves for sustained engagement around the issue of policing. And they're telling their stories. They're describing the presumption of criminality that attaches to black youth in terms that are compelling and that powerfully dramatize that racial profiling is an affront to the dignity of black men and women. It strikes at the core of our sense of citizenship, and when it is targeted, as it so often is, at young people, it distorts the formation of their identity as citizens at precisely the time when this country should speak affirmatively and unequivocally to embrace the emerging adult citizen. We should be welcoming our young people of all races into their role as leaders, as voters, as decision makers. But instead, we too often greet black and brown young men and women of color at the door of adulthood with a pat down, a frisk, a strip search, and an arrest. So we're at the moment when we can and we should engage this issue. And as we talked at LDF about how to engage it, we've been thinking a lot about short-term and long-term. One of the strategies that we undertook, we began literally the week after Mike Brown was killed. And in some ways, it came out of our historical experience. So you know that we litigated and strategized and won the landmark case of Brown versus Board of Education in 1954. But we also know that there was massive resistance to the Brown decision, right? And so implementation was deeply problematic. And many of us know that to the extent school integration began to happen or school desegregation began to happen in the North, it happened after the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. Well, why was that? What did the Civil Rights Act of 1964 contain that was so important? Well, it was Title VI of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 that said that the federal government would no longer give funds to programs that engage in discrimination. And what this meant was that school districts would now not get federal money if they continued to maintain segregation. And so that's why people like me began to be bused to school in Queens in 1967. Not because of the 54 decision, but because of the 54 decision combined with the 64 Civil Rights Act. The lesson for that is that lawsuits are great, good intentions are great, but money is really important. It's a powerful incentive for change. So after Mike Brown was killed, one of the first things we did was draft a comprehensive letter to Attorney General Holder. And it's in your materials. And in that letter, we sought to get at the issue of the more than half and nearly $1 billion in grants that the federal government gives to police districts all over this country. We wanted to go the federal route because we wanted to try and touch as many police departments as possible, right? Because you know that, like education, law enforcement is largely a local activity, which is part of what makes it hard to get your hands around it and produce systemic change. But it's also true that if you want to change culture, you have to touch a lot of places. So we started looking at the federal grant program to police departments. And we wanted to think through how could we, through that grant program, begin to embed a set of practices that ultimately would change culture. Not this year, not next year, right? I'm talking about Clifford Glover 42 years ago, so I'm now looking to, you know, for my kids' kids to have a different culture. But we better get started. So in that letter, we basically set out how we believe the Department of Justice can, and under the obligations of Title VI of the Civil Rights Act, should and must require certain things to go along with that money. We included in that training around implicit bias, training around the de-escalation of encounters, right? How you diffuse encounters between police officers and citizens rather than turn them up. Effective training on encounters with the mentally ill, because if you think about Ezell Ford in California, and if you think about Kajemi Powell in St. Louis, you know, the police roll up on him, he says he's carrying a knife, he says shoot me, and they shoot him. So something needs to happen around encounters with the mentally ill. We talked about police body-worn cameras. We also talked about data collection, because as the FBI director said today, you know, we don't have the data. I can tell you how many police officers were feloniously killed this year, last year, and the year before. And by the way, the number's going down dramatically. But I cannot tell you how many people were shot by police officers. I cannot tell you how many unarmed people were shot by police officers. I cannot tell you how many people by race were shot. We don't have the data. And so we're forced into this kind of anecdotal communication that has made this issue sound like it's an old wives' tale, which is why people say, well, how is it suddenly happening now? Well, because we didn't have the data to back it up. So we need that data. And we should have that data, because in order for the federal government to do its job under Title VI and ensure that a program doesn't discriminate, they need to know something. And so they should be asking certain questions about the diversity of a police force that gets the grant money. They should be asking about the civil rights complaints that have been filed against that police force and what the resolution of those complaints have been. They should be asking questions that set different kinds of incentives. Questions about discipline, questions about accountability, questions about officers who don't unholster their weapon and don't shoot. So we filed that letter. We sent that letter immediately to Attorney General Holder. And we've met with him and his staff, and I have raised this with him and with the president, and I testified before the 21st Century Policing Task Force, and we're continuing to press this issue of funding, and you should too. It's your money. It's your money. And all we're asking is that it come with the condition of fairness. That it come with the condition that those people that we equip with the power to take life on behalf of the state do so with a level of training, supervision — the training without the supervision doesn't work — and accountability, without which none of it works, to receive that money and that support. So that was our kind of short-term effort. So we thought also that, in addition to the short-term, you know, what's the long-term issue? And this is the one that I think, you know, perhaps in the question and answer period, I'd love to hear more from you about. But I really believe in some ways this is kind of the unfinished business of Brown. Because at the end of the day, it's not just about the shooting, right? If in fact it was an accident that the officer shot Akai Gurley in the stairwell of public housing. If you shot someone by accident, what would you do? Call an EMT? Run down the stairs and start trying to do CPR? Or would you text your union? Tamir Rice is killed within 2 seconds of the police arriving. 2 seconds, 12-year-old child with a toy gun in a park. I don't know where else you should be playing with a toy gun. I think a park is probably it. But it's not just his killing. It's not giving him first aid. It's when his sister comes running out screaming in agony, "You killed my baby brother." It's tackling that 14-year-old sister and handcuffing her and putting her in the police car and telling the mom, "If you don't stop screaming, we'll cuff you too." So what's that about? That's about the ongoing narrative in this country about the value of black life. That's why the statement "Black Lives Matter" is so important, because it engages that question. And you can explain away, not credibly, but you can explain away that you thought you were under threat from somebody who looked like they had a gun. But you can't explain away tackling a 14-year-old girl and handcuffing her. So we have to begin to ask ourselves something about that deeper question too. And what's the source of the resilience of this narrative that devalues black life? And how do we get at it? You might be asking, what does that have to do with being a lawyer? And I'm telling you that it has everything to do with it. That the context in which we litigate, the narrative about what equality means, about what justice means, matters. It matters to your jury. It matters to a grand jury who hears an officer say about a teenager, "I felt like a 5-year-old compared to him." It makes a story that's even implausible seem plausible. I get it. I get that Mike Brown's a big guy. But so is Officer Wilson. He was 6'1", 240. Mike Brown 6'4", 290. And the officer's in a car, got a gun, a radio, should have had a taser, but said it made him uncomfortable, pepper spray, cuffs. And he felt like a 5-year-old? That story only can be credible if you already have in you the idea of what this big teenager really is. And we can pretend to ourselves that that somehow is not part of this work, but it is part of this work. And so at LDF, we're engaging more in the issue of shaping narrative also, as we did in the past. In the past, however, in the post-World War II period, there was a narrative that was set for us. We were America. We had triumphed over Nazism. And we were the land of equality. And the economy was, you know, on the upswing in the 50s. And so there were all kinds of elements to the story that were there. And LDF and Thurgood Marshall, they were brilliant. They knew how to build the narrative, right? From 1935, the first case on the road to Brown when they sued the law school that I'm on leave from and that I've taught at for 20 years, University of Maryland Law School, challenging segregation there, a case they brought in municipal court in Baltimore City and won. And then they began to pick them off, right? And then they went to Missouri, and then they went to Texas, and they went to Oklahoma. And they started with the law schools and the graduate schools, all the while wanting to get to K-12 education, because they knew that, you know, we will have less resistance to the idea of black doctors and lawyers. So they were shaping narrative by the litigation. So anybody telling you that narrative is not part of the job of lawyers, that's bunk. They were bringing the courts along over 20 years. So there does have to be work done around the narrative. Last thing I really want to talk about is what I call the unfinished business of Brown. So yes, there's this narrative about who we are and the value of our lives. And I believe that this is directly traceable to some of what got discussed in Brown, but didn't quite come out in the opinion. Now, I'm hoping that they're still teaching Brown in law school. Yes? Wonderful. I'm still waiting for the Supreme Court confirmation hearing, which they ask lots of questions about Brown, right? Because I feel like it's a seminal decision that every lawyer who hopes to rise to any bench actually should be really conversant with, but I very rarely hear it. So you'll recall that in Brown, Chief Justice Warren talked about some really important things in that very, very short opinion, right? One of the important pieces of that opinion is that it essentially exposes segregation as being about racial subordination. That's not the words that Warren uses, but that's essentially what he's saying, right? What the court is saying is segregation is not this thing where it's just nice that black people are here and white people are here and this is how we do it in the South and we kind of like it. No, it actually is designed to send a subordinating message. So that's huge. That was powerful. In the opinion, he also talks about the harm of that message on black children, on the dignity of black children. And so many of you know about the famous doll test, right? And the work of Dr. Kenneth Clark, and just, you know, a pitch for Dr. Kenneth Clark and his wife, Mamie Clark, two incredibly brilliant social scientists and psychologists who did so much more than the doll test and who relied on so much more than the doll test in their testimony and in the materials that they presented in the Brown case. And in fact, it wasn't just Dr. Clark, but it was 30 social scientists. 30 social scientists who together penned an appendix to our brief in Brown, and I've included it in your materials because I want people to have it. And what they said in this brief is they talked about the harm to black children. But what they also talked about in this brief, but which didn't make it into Chief Justice Warren's opinion, is the harm to white children. The harm of segregation to white children. And what did they say? They said a lot of things. Well, let's try this without the glasses. This should be interesting. So they said that segregation on the majority group, on majority children, white children, can cause confusion, conflict, moral cynicism, disrespect for authority. Others may react by guilt feelings. Here's an interesting one that some of this confusion, they said, comes from being taught the moral, religious, and democratic principles of the brotherhood of man and the importance of justice and fair play by the same persons and institutions who, in their support of racial segregation and related practices, seem to be acting in a prejudiced and discriminatory manner. They said some may react by developing an unwholesome, rigid, and uncritical idealization of all authority figures, their parents, strong political and economic leaders. They may despise the weak. I mean, there's a whole... And I think that's what we're living with. I think we're living with the consequence of never having engaged this. And so for that reason, I think one of the issues that we're spending a lot of time talking about at LDF and that we've engaged a little bit in litigation and want to do some more with is the ongoing issue of housing segregation. Yes, I'm bringing back the S word. You know, we had two paths to go in the early 1950s. We could have gone with housing segregation or educational segregation, right? Because we'd won Shelley versus Kramer in 1948, which ended racially restrictive covenants, at least, you know, judicial enforcement of racially restrictive covenants. St. Louis, by the way. And we went with education. And then the expectation was that we would then turn to housing. But you know what happened after Brown. We had massive resistance, right? And we ended up having to spend decades, right, trying to make Brown real. And we didn't get the Fair Housing Act until 1968. But housing segregation is critically important. In fact, if we'd solved housing segregation, it would have solved educational segregation. I don't think we can afford it anymore as a country. We remain in a country where the economic vitality and prospects for an individual and a family is still tied to housing. It's still the anchor means of accumulating wealth. It still is the principal asset around which families and communities arrange themselves. And it still lies at the heart of many of the issues that we see that relate to the economic condition of African Americans, the educational opportunity for African Americans, and so forth. And so housing segregation has kind of reappeared as a really critically important issue. Let me explain to you what I mean by it, because you're probably thinking, well, we don't have to live next to white people, and I know all the stuff that people say, and I'm really asking you to delve into this, and that's part of why in the materials, you have an excellent paper by a scholar, Richard Rothstein from UCLA, who wrote a paper called The Making of Ferguson about the history of housing discrimination that created St. Louis County. And I love the paper, and I love Professor Rothstein, and he and I do talks together all the time, because I think it's so important for us to wake up and recognize that the landscape that we see in this country was created. It's not that some people just wanted to live here and other people just wanted to live here. It's not even just created by mean racist people who didn't want to live next to black people. That certainly in the North, the housing patterns of this country was created by the affirmative policies of the federal government, by decades of policies, laws, and investments. What do I mean by that? From the time the federal government began to insure mortgages in 1934 until 1968, maybe the early 1970s, 98% of those mortgages went to white people. Until the early 1960s, HUD policy required racially restrictive covenants in those homes that they were going to insure. Public housing was built by race. I'm not saying like maybe that's what they thought. I mean, it's there in the documents, right? Neighborhoods were ranked. When we talk about redlining, they were ranked by how white they were, right? Highest values assigned to the whitest neighborhoods and thus the property values associated with them, which is how you then accumulate your wealth and your assets. Investments, federal government provided the investments for the highways that created the white suburbs. And we provided the tax breaks to the developers like those who made Levittown and other racially segregated suburbs. We did that as a country. So that's investment, policy, law over decades. Now, in this country, we have the unfortunate habit of when we discover that we've done something really terrible in the racial realm, our response is to stop doing it. I mean, that's good, but like we just stopped doing it, right? And so that's what we did with the Fair Housing Act of 1968. We stopped doing it, right? It was passed the week of Martin Luther King's assassination as segregated cities all over the North burned. And the Fair Housing Act of 1968 was passed. And it's meant to get at discriminators, you know, actual people who engage in racial discrimination in the provision of housing, absolutely should. But it was also meant to get at policies that perpetuate the segregation and the segregative policies that the federal government had engaged in for decades. Fair Housing Act is essentially an anti-segregation statute. So I was at the Supreme Court 2 weeks ago when the court heard oral argument and whether or not disparate impact can be the basis of liability under the Fair Housing Act. This is critically important. Because trying to pick off each discriminator and proving that they in fact have a malice in their heart is not exactly the way that you really deal with the kind of policies that created the housing landscape that I just talked to you about. So we have never, on the other side, created the policies and investments that would undo what had been done before the Fair Housing Act. We just stopped doing the bad things. So that's our second focus now, is looking at this issue of housing segregation. And part of what we're doing at LDF, in addition to our litigation, which remains our kind of cornerstone, is bringing other tools into the toolbox. This year we're launching the Thurgood Marshall Institute. It will be a research, policy, and strategic communications hub embedded within LDF that will allow us to engage the issues of narrative, that will allow us to do more organizing around the country in the places where we do our work, that will allow us to engage in strategic communications, that will allow us to develop the research that we need to be able to build out the kind of litigation, policy, and advocacy work that we think is essential. So I say that to you because I want you to understand, as law students, that to be a civil rights lawyer has always meant, and now even more intensely means, gathering this array of tools to use to pull together in order to make change. It will never be sufficient to just be in the courtroom. And we really believe that at this moment we are at a moment almost of a perfect storm. And we think many people feel that. So we are inviting you, everyone, to join us in conversation, to share with us your ideas, to be colleagues to us, as you have been in the past. It's one of the reasons I'm running all over the country talking to people, because I want to engage people who are committed to change in this conversation. But we truly believe that we have to make some big bets for our children, for our grandchildren, and for the future of this democracy. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Ifill. For such a rich and challenging set of reflections, I'm sure that there are many questions in the room, and we're fortunate because we will have some time this evening for substantial conversation. While you are getting your questions together, however, I wanted to make a couple of announcements and provide an opportunity for someone else to make an announcement as well. The first announcement is that at the end of this lecture, you are all invited to a reception which will take place just outside this room in the hall. There will be an opportunity to talk amongst yourselves and perhaps with Professor Ifill if her schedule allows her to stay for a while. And the second thing that I wanted to say was to publicly acknowledge the indispensable assistance of my assistant, Benjamin Mintzer, in taking care of the logistics of making sure that this evening happened on so many different levels. So thank you, Ben. And finally, I would like to invite, if he's still here, Ashok Chandran. Ashok, are you here? Yes. Who is representing the Columbia Journal of Race and Law, which is organizing in partnership with the Black American Law Students Association, the Paul Robeson Conference, which will take place later this semester. And he's going to tell you a little bit about that conference right now. Come on up.
Hi, everyone. As Professor Thomas mentioned, my name is Ashok Chandran, and I'm editor-in-chief of the Columbia Journal of Race and Law. And this year, for the first time, we actually have the honor of co-sponsoring the annual Paul Robeson Conference with Columbia's Black Law Students Association in conjunction with Professor Thomas's Center for Law and Culture. And this year's conference is going to be touching on a lot of the issues that Professor Ifill mentioned in her talk, specifically by through the lens of Bayard Rustin's seminal civil rights piece, From Protest to Politics, The Future of the Civil Rights Movement. And in that piece, Rustin discusses generally the nature of protest politics and the ways in which grassroots organizing can affect larger scale changes, and the ways in which grassroots organizing can then lead to policy change. And particularly in light of recent events surrounding the non-indictments in Ferguson and Staten Island, but even before that with the Occupy movement and then internationally with the Arab Spring phenomenon, we've seen an uptick in grassroots organizing in a very public and very newsworthy way. So this year's conference is going to analyze how these new developments can shape our activism as civil rights advocates and shape the work that we do going forward. In five major areas, looking at mass incarceration and immigration reform, neoliberal capitalism and economic justice, voting rights and campaign finance, social goods such as housing and education, and intersectional erasure, which is particularly relevant for Bayard Rustin himself, who was written out of the mainstream story of the civil rights movement as a gay black man. So this year's conference will be taking place on April 10th and 11th, starting Friday evening at dinner time, with a roundtable discussion to frame the entire conversation about the piece, and then the series of panels will take place all day Saturday. So I hope that all of you can make it out for part, if not all, of the conference. So I'll turn it back over to Professor Thomas with that. Thanks, everyone.
All right, so we're not going to ask you to stand because we're in a lecture room which is equipped with mics at your seats. As I acknowledge you, I would ask you to press the button which is next to the mic in front of you so that we can be sure to have the benefit of voice recording your question. I would also ask you, if you would, to make sure that what you say is indeed a question rather than a disquisition. And we'll have some time to engage in conversation. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to ask Professor Ifill to come back up, but this has been so incredibly rich. Maybe I'll lead off. Mm-hmm. The talk that you gave us, for me, was really insightful in making the connections between racial justice and democratic justice. Mm-hmm. Right? So we should think of the question of racial justice as a question of political justice. So that means we ought to think not only about the ways in which black lives matter, but about the ways in which black citizenship matters, mm-hmm. and about the ways in which one of the unfinished projects of the civil rights movement and the claims that the civil rights movement has made on this country is the completion of racial democracy. And yet we live at a moment which in many ways is a moment of de-democratization across so many axes. I can just say the word Citizens United, and it resonates with everybody in the room insofar as it has become a symbol of the capture of our democratic process by rich and powerful political interests who have crowded out the possibilities for the kind of grassroots, on-the-ground, participatory democracy that I think whose tradition the civil rights movement, I think, in so many ways helped to advance and to keep alive. So given the larger de-democratization of American politics, what do you think is some of the special responsibility of those who are working on issues of racial justice as democratic justice to make connections between the struggle of black and brown people to be recognized as full and equal citizens on the one hand, and the larger structural challenge to the very possibility of democracy as such, not just for people of color, but for the American body politic as a whole.
Thank you.
That was a question.
It was. But you know what? What's interesting is that was my alternate talk. So I'm going to give you the mini alternate talk. because the problem is even worse than you're suggesting. So we know Citizens United, we know voter suppression, right? But even those things, at least in the context of thinking about kind of racial representation, continue to be viewed through the lens of voting, right? An election of, you know, a candidate of your choice. And if we're, you know, for many people, it's the election of African Americans having a diverse, you know, kind of leadership, which is all very important and all very nice. And I have been a voting rights lawyer for years, and so I have worked to advance that for those who have not had access. The work that we've been doing in Texas around the Texas voter ID law is critically important. A law, by the way, that not only crowds out African Americans and Latinos and the elderly, but also women, many of whom don't have an ID that is in their legal name. And you know, when a federal judge says it's a poll tax because it's going to cost you $40 to get the underlying documents to get that ID, that like that is real. But let's talk about Ferguson for a moment. You know, when we went down to Ferguson, we went with the plans to do a 360. We didn't go with just criminal justice folks. As a matter of fact, the first people we sent were our organizers, because we saw that this was something happening on the ground. This wasn't about a lawsuit. This was about people and voice. And so our organizers have been very engaged from the beginning. And so we were, you know, our organizer was getting tear gassed, right? So we went into it thinking we were going to approach it from a lot of different ways. When we did send lawyers, we sent education lawyers, we sent voting rights lawyers, we sent criminal justice lawyers, we wanted to know a lot about this community. We wanted to know a lot about Mike Brown's life and the life of his colleagues. And what we wanted to know was, if Mike Brown had lived and none of us knew his name, what were the civil rights challenges facing him and this community? So we wanted to know about education, and we wanted to know about economic opportunity if Mike Brown had lived. And we wanted to know about political participation. And you probably heard something about political participation. You probably heard, right, that here's this town that's 67% black. Six out of the seven, or is it five out of the six, council members are white. The mayor is white, right? And you've probably also heard that the voting turnout in the prior municipal election was 6% for African Americans. And actually 17% for white people, which is really bad too. Now, as you know, voting rights is what LDF does. That's our bread and butter. We have rarely seen numbers that low. And you know, and so people said this is a shame, and Reverend Sharpton said quite rightly, this is an insult to our children, and you know, all true. But the great thing about being a civil rights lawyer is that you just learn how smart the people are. There's always, when you see something strange, dig deeper. So the first thing we learned is that municipal elections in Ferguson are held in March and April. Now, if this were Alabama, we would immediately say, we know why that's happening, right? We would say, why would you hold an election not when you're likely to get the turnout, right, in November, and not in the even-numbered years when people are coming out for the presidential election and so forth? Why would you hold municipal elections in the off years in March and April? So you immediately are killing turnout by deciding to hold elections at that absurd time. But even that still doesn't get me to 6%. And then when we looked at the presidential election, the turnout was like 58%. So the disparity was huge. So it wasn't that people just didn't care about voting. What was it about these elections that made them vote with their feet? And this to me seemed very logical, because I knew that something had to be amiss in that community for the reaction to Mike Brown's killing to be what it was. Because we, you know, Eric Garner had just been killed before that. And we didn't go out on the street that night. I mean, some of us did. But for the most part, we had a whole set of issues that we knew how to channel and how to perform and react and who to talk to and all that stuff. These folks felt like they just had to go. Why did they feel that way? If you look at the structure of governance of Ferguson, if this were any other place, we would be calling it a failed state. Ferguson is run, presumably, in terms of its elected officials, by a city council that is a part-time city council. Each member receives a stipend of $250 a month. A part-time mayor, who receives a stipend of $350 a month. The person who has the real power is a man named John Shaw. I've been outing him for some time now. I even wrote an op-ed in USA Today, which is in your materials, about him. He's a man with the power. He has the power to hire and fire the police chief. He nominates the judges that are then endorsed by the city council, the judges who essentially hold this poor community hostage with these traffic fines and court costs that you've probably read about. And some folks, Arch City Defenders and others, have filed a suit against the what they call the debtors' prisons, right? The second largest source of revenue of the town of Ferguson is court costs and fees and traffic fines. So essentially, this is a community being run on poor people, right, to hold up this government that's not really government. So let's look at what we have here. So we have a part-time mayor, we have a part-time city council, we have a town manager who's unelected, who really has all the power, right? And then we tell ourselves that we want turnout and we want black people on the city council. See, this is one of those times when we get really myopic. Because look, I'm a black person who loves black people. For $250 a month, I don't know how much city councilin' I'm doing. For $350 a month as the mayor, I'm not sure that I'm making a plan for the financial future of the community, and I'm not sure I'm gonna engage at that level. And so when you look at some of the surrounding towns around Ferguson that are run by black elected officials, they also rely on traffic fines and costs. It's no different. More diverse police forces, to be sure. And maybe wouldn't have had the kind of ugly reaction that we saw. But in terms of the condition, the democratic condition of the people, it's the same. So is that the plan? To get turnout really high to elect black people into the $250 a month city council and the $350 a month mayor? I think that there's something else that we should be looking at. And the phenomenon that we see in Ferguson is a phenomenon of ungovernance that exists in working class suburbs around the country. It's not just unique, although St. Louis County does have 90 jurisdictions, so it's particularly bizarre, but all over the country, in which you have a population that has moved to the suburbs, not the green leafy suburbs that people think about when they hear that word, but kind of working class suburbs, people who actually need the kind of services that you would find in the city, but who now live in the suburbs, suburbs that were created because people want to get out of the city. And if you read Richard Rothstein's paper that, you know, connected to DSEG litigation and moving, you know, first it was white because they were moving from St. Louis, and right, and so created by all the other racial forces that you can imagine, but created by people who were trying to get away from the city and really were not particularly fond of having a strong government. They didn't need it. And now you have people trapped in these working class suburbs with this non-governance. And we delude ourselves into believing that the answer is just turn out and just elect new people. I'm not sure about that. So one of the projects that we're engaging in is trying to develop a convening for folks in Ferguson. We did some work down there training people on how to do recalls. They wanted to recall some elected officials and how to do write-ins. But also to begin to think about what are the options for actually changing the structure of your government, of your local government. Let's be more ambitious than just electing new people into the new thing, into the old thing. And so when we talk about this issue of democracy, that's what I mean. I mean that, like Lonnie Guinier, who says that, you know, black men are the canary in the mine, that what we see happening to black people tells us about the health of our democracy. It tells us when something is wrong. Those people went on the street because there was no other place to go. There is no real governance there. And they knew it. So when we see that happen, assume the people know their own community. Don't assume that they're not smart. Ask yourself the question, what is happening there? And then use that question, at least in my view, to interrogate the state of our democracy writ large, not just in Ferguson, but in places all over this country.
Thank you for a very good lecture. I have a following in Professor Thomas's footsteps, I have a disquisitional question.
Let me get some water.
This is Black History Month. In 1964, Malcolm X gave a speech called The Ballot or the Bullet. And in it, he makes a statement, sitting at the table doesn't make you a diner. You must be eating something on a plate. Being here in America doesn't make you an American. So that's part of the context. Brown versus the Board of Education, I think the point you made about Chief Justice Warren leaving out the part of the effect of segregation on white people is very significant, because Brown versus the Board was supposed to address the separate, the fact that black folks did not have the equal resources for the institutions as white people did. And the effect of Brown versus the Board was really to disempower and destroy black institutions and the jobs of black teachers, I mean, all the way down the line, so that black life became pushed and became absorbed by white life and white institutions. So that was another aspect of it. Frederick Douglass said at one point that he was a citizen three times. Every time the United States had there was a war going on, they made him a citizen, and then his citizenship was lost. So my question is, given that context, and given that for black folks in this country, the question of our citizenship has never really been a choice. It's been something that has been thrust upon us, forced upon us, but it's never been a choice. What is your view of the right of people to make a choice, to say, you know what, we haven't been part of this, we don't want to be part of this, we want to create something separate? And what's your view of that?
Yeah, I'm not with that, but you know, I understand that impulse. I would even disagree a little bit about the effect of Brown. Okay. And the reason for the effect of Brown. There was actually really nothing wrong with Brown. I mean, I don't think Chief Justice Warren would have gotten an opinion that included the information about the effect on white people as a written opinion. Like, I understand as a matter of pragmatism why he didn't pursue it, but I agree with you that it is significant because it set a narrative about what desegregation or integration meant. And the narrative was it was something nice that you do for black people.
Right.
Not that it was something imperative to the American ideal, to our economy, to our future, to our democracy, and so forth. And that is significant. The truth is, there were never enough resources, never, nor would there have been enough resources to conduct two parallel, equally funded systems in most of the South. And Marshall et al. Knew that. There were some places where it might have been possible, most places it wouldn't have been possible. So we were always going to get the short end of the stick if there were two. And so the idea was if we integrate them, we're going to get more. The part where I take issue is people confusing Brown with a response to Brown. And I think it's really important that, you know, when we were doing the 60th last year, I spent a lot of time talking with my staff and putting out stuff on my website and giving all these speeches about massive resistance and what that really means, because it keeps coming back, actually, in a variety of ways. When you think about the reaction to Brown, when you think about the United States Supreme Court issuing a decision and then being kind of afraid and saying, well, you know, we're going to leave it to the local people to kind of figure it out, and you get 102 members of Congress signing a Southern Manifesto saying we will use all legal means necessary to essentially subvert this decision. And you get a governor of the state of Virginia saying we will massively resist this. And you get jurisdictions in places like Virginia deciding to close the public schools for 5 years rather than integrate. You're essentially talking about the beginnings of a contract being broken. It's so interesting to me when I talk about education all the time and people talk about Brown and so forth. No, that's when we broke the contract with our kids. When we decided to do things like that, to close the schools for 5 years rather than integrate. There was nothing to prevent buses from running from Flushing to Jamaica, where I lived in Queens, rather than just from Jamaica to Flushing. That wasn't the fault of Brown. That was the fault of the reaction to Brown. And it's important to segregate out those two because, of course, there's a lesson in it. There's a lesson about entrenched racism, right? And the limits of litigation, right, to deal with entrenched racism. About winning battles and wars, you know, and having to be prepared for both. And I think that's the knowledge or the information that I've certainly tried to internalize. And that's why I say that for the LDF that I lead, litigation will not be the only tool. That we have to be engaged in these other pieces as well, because we have to constantly be managing and engaging in trying to affect the zeitgeist, the reality of how people really live and what people really think. And if we're honest with ourselves, we failed. We let the atmosphere be taken over. We let our language be co-opted. We let our ideas about democracy, which you were just describing, be kind of co-opted and managed. And we ended up in a more defensive posture because of the overwhelming nature of the resistance, which in some ways we didn't anticipate. So that's an important lesson, at least for me, to anticipate that level of resistance, which is why I talk about, you know, changing culture and the long term, the short term and the long term battle. But I just don't believe, I mean, you know, one of the things I've always been, and the LDF attorneys have always been, is both visionary and pragmatic. And actually, I don't want to live in my own little place. I want to be able to live wherever I want to live. I want to be what I was promised. I want to be a full citizen. And that's a constantly challenged and interrogated term, because we've never really kind of seen it. And so we're kind of trying to make it. But it isn't something that just, you know, I want that. It isn't something that exists, because we see it in all different iterations, whether it's in LGBT community, whether it's Latinos, whether it's immigrants, whether it's prisoners, whether it's, right, because prisoners are also still citizens, right? So there are all these ways in which we are still having to deal with that. And in any case, that's what I've committed myself to. So
let me just say, my only point was that people should have a choice on that. Whatever it is, there should be a discussion about that.
Exactly. You know, I'm open for discussion.
Okay, I'm going to practice democracy, and I'm going to expressly call for a question from someone in the audience who socially identifies as a woman. Yes.
Well,
please, press the button. So
hi, I have a question. Yes, I socially identify as a woman. And it's interesting, because listening to you talk about culture, I've worked as a lawyer and as a diversity professional, and this unconscious bias question is something that a corporate America is dealing with. And what I'm wondering is, you know, you talk about addressing it from all different angles. What's your view on corporate America joining that conversation to address this unconscious bias? So in the police force, on the ground, in companies, because it's you know, so prevalent everywhere, and so many of us work in corporations.
Well, I think it's really important. I mean, I think there's a larger question about corporations and you know, and what and democratic responsibility around all the set of issues that we're talking about, right? And maybe that's a third talk. But one of the things, this is almost like talking about the election system. You know, we make a lot out of the diversification, for example, of the police force, right? And so, you know, it's very important for people to know that, you know, Ferguson has this nearly all-white police force. It's 67% black. It's really important. And while I think that is really important, I, at every opportunity, also talk about this culture of policing, which also affects black officers. I do not want people to think that diversity is the answer, right? Because the culture affects, look, everybody is affected by the culture of their workplace, right? If you're a professor here, you're affected by the culture of Columbia, I'm affected by the culture of LDF, whatever. Police officers are affected by their culture. They walk into that culture and they absorb it. And so if you think that the answer, you know, I've lived for 20 years in Baltimore, very diverse police force, also, you know, under federal investigation, right? At the behest of the commissioner, who seems quite, you know, to be quite interesting and open and progressive, but still, we have our problems because it's in the culture. So one of the things that's important about the implicit bias piece is that it's not to be, I cannot tell you how many times I've engaged a conversation about implicit bias and been met with a conversation about diversity. And while diversity really is important, because, you know, and I've written about this a lot in the context of judges, we should just remember that that's not the answer, right, alone. That you really do have to get into this question of bias and what you think and what you have been trained to think about who different sets of people are and how you react to it. Here's the rub with police officers. So we say we all have these biases. The FBI director said it today. Everybody, you know, what did he say? Everybody's a racist or something. I mean, I'm, you know, it sounds like the movie Crash, and that makes me crazy. But because there is something about anti-black racism that's actually quite specific, right? So, but to the extent we all have biases, and we do, of whatever kind, right? We encounter each other. We meet, right? And we have our implicit biases, right? I have my biases about you because you're black or because you're a woman or because you identify in a certain way or because you're gay or because you're my professor or because you're elderly or because I hear your accent and it sounds like you come from this place or that place. And what happens, for the most part, with thinking people is they have their split-second reactions, which we have to have or else our brains would explode, right? And then we start to adjust. We're in a conversation, and we make different kinds of decisions, and we are capable of turning right where we would have turned left. And we say, well, actually, I found out that, you know, we have a lot in common, or this person I thought I would have so much in common with, I actually don't. I don't like them. Whatever it is, we take the time to figure that out. That's why when you see that police car roll up on Tamir Rice and shoot him in 2 seconds, you know that there is a training problem. Because when you have a gun in your hand, and you have the power of the state behind you to take life, and you don't even take the seconds it takes to like assess the situation, to say drop the gun, to call in a, if you think he's so dangerous, a hostage negotiator, whatever it is, right? So part of the issue around policing is they have implicit biases too, police officers of every race and gender, right? And they need to be trained especially in how in a short period of time to manage their biases. And the whole idea that racial subordination and racism is the province of horrible, evil people, which is something that, frankly, the Supreme Court has pushed us to, right? The constant search for racism, the search for intentional discrimination, as opposed to being about structures and systems that exist on the outside but are also embedded within us, right, in ways that don't require me to determine that you are an evil person, you know, has led us on this kind of quest. And which is, you know, leads us to the, there are a few bad apples, right? As opposed to, this is a whole force of people who we brought into this profession largely when they're young, right? Because that's the, you know, we recruit, they're 18, they're 19, you know, let's train them and give them a gun and send them out there, right? Without any exposure to all of this, of what it takes thinking people to do to manage their encounters with one another. And then we expect the outcome to be different. So in terms of corporate America, I mean, I think I'm happy that they're embracing implicit bias. I hope so. I know that there are some people who are, I think it was Megan Smith, who was a vice president at Google. I think she's in the administration now. She actually was requiring implicit bias training for all Google employees. I thought that was kind of cool. I think that's important. I think we're going to need to do some studies of what the training does. I mean, at the end of the day, what does it change in terms of decision points, in terms of promotions and interviews and, you know, like, so we need to, We need to play with this a lot, because I also, you know, when people start agreeing with me a lot in mass, you know, like today when the FBI director was talking about, you know, implicit bias, which was wonderful, but then I get nervous because I'm thinking, what, you know, so it means we have to go further. It means that we shouldn't be, if you know, if the FBI director is on board with it, which is great, I should be somewhere else, right? I should be like asking for more. So I do think we're in a moment where people are understanding what implicit bias is. It actually is, you know, can be scientifically proven. There's good training out there. We need to be making that happen. And then we need to be engaged in the long term and figuring out what does that training yield. And again, as I said, you know, the issue of supervision becomes very important. What happens when you depart from the training? And I would just say that again about, you know, the police officer issue. At the end of the day, you're going to hear a lot about training, but you very rarely hear the words accountability. Which you hear in a corporation, people understand, you didn't get the deal done. You know, anybody who's running a good workspace knows there's got to be supervision and accountability. But suddenly when we start talking about the police, we just talk about training like it's just unmoored somewhere out there. But until we see accountability, that's when you know that Black Lives Matter. When people pay a consequence, a price for taking life. And so, you know, I think it's a beginning. But we have to kind of go further than that.
This gentleman in the back. Yeah.
Thank you. I take issue with the Brown versus Board of Education. And I'll put it in this context. What is the response? I'll put it in this context. What is the responsibility of legal defense fund for the consequences of Brown versus Board of Education? I grew up in Knoxville, Tennessee. Knoxville College is that close from closing. For all practical purposes, it's closed. There's 17 buildings on the campus that are empty. Morristown College, the same thing, is already been closed, sold off, windows still there. These are the vestiges of Brown versus Board of Education. When I graduated from high school, I couldn't go to UT. I went to Tennessee State, had a good education. I couldn't do, a young kid now, like me, not any money, couldn't do what I did then at Tennessee State. All because of Brown versus Board of Education initially, and then the guy versus University of Tennessee brought down a black woman subsequent to that period. What is the legal defense fund responsibility in that matter? And so I probably won't get another opportunity, so let me just raise a second issue and ask the same question with regards to it. Within 10 blocks of this school that I went to law school at, 100 black men were arrested. And the only thing, response we get from this law school, well, not from the law school, from Columbia, is that the Columbia Spectator, the student newspaper, covers the matter and has no a voice. Now, when these cases came on for trial, one of the, at their first court appearance from those from grant houses, the state could not even get all 30 of the people to the courtroom. They could only get 3 out of 30. Department of Corrections had problems getting them there. What is the responsibility of this law school that is taking, where Columbia is moving north in the gentrification with making Silicon Valley in Harlem, moving black people out of these housing projects by arresting these number of black men who they're offering 15 years in jail, you get rid of a generation. What is the responsibility of the legal defense fund? What is the responsibility of the law school?
Thank you, sir.
I'll take the first one. So, no, I do not accept your premise, as I suggested in my earlier answer, that the landscape that you described can be laid at the feet of the legal defense fund. The reason for the decimation of the colleges that you talk about is racism. Oh, I let you have your disquisition, I'm at my disquisition. And as I said earlier, the one-way integration that happened because of racism, not because of the Legal Defense Fund or because of Brown. And in fact, we spent 25, 30 years trying to create out of Brown what we had hoped to accomplish. And that meant championing the right of students to be able to get access to quality education, protecting black universities, in the Adams case and many others. I'm sorry, sir, that's just the fact. Maybe not your school, but we can't be everywhere. And that's essentially what the work is that we've done at every turn. Unfortunately, as you know, there are other forces at work in the world There's a United States Supreme Court that worked to unravel what could have been the promise of Brown beginning in the late 1970s and early 1980s. There is the economic condition that we find ourselves in that makes the statement that you made true, that our children do not have, for many of us, the same chances that we had. There are profound changes in our educational system, not just for black people, that was created by fear of black people and white flight and the abandonment of public education in this country across the board. So there are many conditions that have produced the results that you're describing. And I do not lay those conditions at the feet of the Legal Defense Fund. Our work has been always to try and create something different. And as I said earlier, it is, I think, an important lesson about the power and the rigidness of white supremacy and racism in countering efforts at being progressive. It's one of the reasons why, you know, I say today that when people talk about demographics, people say, well, it's all going to be over soon. You know, by 2030, we're going to be this, or by 2040, we're going to be this. I don't think the numbers are going to solve it. I think that's underestimating the power and the rigidity of anti-black racism and of white supremacy. And we just have to get better at being able to anticipate it and being able to play out the unintended consequences of our efforts.
Ms. Abdul-Mula.
So first, I wanted to thank you for that very enlightening discussion that you presented. And then I also thought it was really interesting your discussion about the need to be strategic, and in particular, the LDF's capitalization of the sense of patriotism and nationalism that was all over the U.S. after World War II, especially in light of an article that we recently read in Professor Thomas's class by Derek Bell, entitled Brown versus Board and the Interest Conversion Convergence Dilemma. I don't know if you're familiar with the article.
Very much so.
Okay, so I wanted to know how relevant you thought the framing of our current historical moment in terms of converging black and white interest is currently, and what exactly we can capitalize on now in terms of points of interest convergence in our countering of these issues that we face today.
Thank you so much. So Derek Bell is a great hero of mine. I loved him. And I'm actually giving the Derek Bell lecture this year at NYU, so I'm very proud of that also. Here's the problem with interest convergence. Yes, you can use it. It's a tool. It's you have to use it strategically, but it actually doesn't get at any of the other stuff that I'm talking about, the underlying kind of narrative. It can advance the ball, but it doesn't really get you there. I'll give you a contemporary example. So right now there is an opportunity to make some real changes around criminal sentencing and mass incarceration in a variety of states with a kind of right-left coalition. There are some people on the right who also don't think mass incarceration is a good thing, right? They will admit that the war on drugs is a failure. They will tell you that we can't afford it. And largely, their eyes were first opened by the economics of it, right? By how much money we spend incarcerating people. And so they come at it from their small government, fiscally conservative standpoint. We come at it from our standpoint about humanity, about social justice, about a criminal justice system that over-criminalizes black people and black conduct and black communities and all that stuff, right? But in that, you come together and you could do some things. And hopefully we will do some things. And already some things are beginning to happen. But that doesn't really get at the issue, right? But here's what I worry about. We're now at the point where violent crime is down to the levels that it was in 1966, right? But our prison population is huge. In 1966, our prison population was the same size as the federal prison population, which is about 250,000, 260,000. But you probably know that we incarcerate 2.1 million people in this country. So our incarceration rate is out of whack, right, with the violent crime rate if you look at 1966. So let's suppose we begin to engage in these measures that begin to bring those numbers down. Are we just waiting for the next really horrific crime, right, to kind of make a turn back? Right, it's like in California where we got rid of the three strikes laws and slowly but surely we're having people released. What happens when some of those people who are released, you know, engage in some kind of recidivism, right? Does that turn, have you really changed the mind about the thing, right? Or have people said, well, it seems like everything's okay now, and so for pragmatic reasons we can come together and trend. So that's worrisome to me, because if you look at our criminal justice practice in this country, we respond to these like moments. Remember in the 1980s when we had some really bad carjackings, then carjacking became a federal crime, you know, for reasons we don't really understand, and not just in the context of race. I mean, we have a federal kidnapping law because of the Lindbergh baby, right? So we have terrible crimes that happen, and then we respond to them, right? And then everybody was scared about the crack epidemic, and, you know, the crack epidemic was a terrible thing, but we glommed all kinds of things on top of it and used pseudoscience and created this, you know, horrible disparity in sentencing for crimes involving crack cocaine. And without question, race was part of that, right? So we want to turn away from that, but we got to get to the issue of why did we think we could do that? Why did we think we could attach these kinds of inhumane sentences to drug crimes for a particular drug that it was thought black people used, right? And so long as we're not really changing that, it's always temporary. So by all means, we should take advantage of opportunities where we see them, but we should never forget that the battle goes a lot deeper if we're talking about really substantive change and cultural change, that we have to engage the question of the treatment and what's underneath the treatment. So, you know, Derrick Bell is absolutely right, but our job also as civil rights lawyers is to hit the sweet spot, is to find that moment when all the conditions are right and where you're pushing suddenly moves you forward, right? You never stop pushing, but then waves happen and you come forward with the wave and then the wave is over, right? And then you got to figure out what else to do. But certainly you have to be conscious of what's happening in the environment and what you can take advantage of, and I think you should take advantage of it, but just not fool yourself into thinking that you've done more than you've done because you've only got a short period of time when that interest converges. Right now, the narrative about who we are as America is very confused, you know? And what do you do when the pie is shrinking and the economy is so terrible? And when there's a shrinking pie, people don't want to share it with anybody. So now we're in a completely different narrative. But at every stage, life has to matter. Black lives have to matter. Humanity has to matter. And that's, I think, the work that kind of remains ongoing beneath the surface.
We have time for a couple more questions, and I'm going to take them, Sriyavan. So this gentleman right here, and then we have a question here, and then I'll let my CRT specialist here come in with a third. All right,
well, my question will be brief, short. I went to church last week, and three cops came to the church and spoke at the dais, and I go to a Catholic church, and they said, come to the meeting, community meeting. So I'm going to the community meeting. And the captain, he looked just like the other white police officers, except his name was Hector. And he grew up in East New York, and I want to go to this meeting, but I'm concerned about what you're saying about this narrative, because if the thinking is embedded in people's families, how they grew up, and the culture, then you might put a Hector on top of the captain spot, right? But he drank the same Kool-Aid. And so I'm going to this meeting, and my question to you is, how can you give me some advice on how to address some of these narratives at this meeting? Because I'm going to be speaking to the captain directly, and hopefully there'll be some more people from the community around where I live, which is on 96th Street in Amsterdam, and it's a real mixture of cultures there. Mm-hmm.
Okay, yes.
My question's more of a strategy perspective. So I guess when you are making decisions in your litigation strategies, at what point do you begin to force the hand of the courts, or do you play a little bit more of, you know, strategic, going little bit because you know that the court will provide bad law? And how do you draw those lines, and where do you make those distinctions?
Thank you for coming. My question is similar to the first gentleman's question, but in regards to the idea of citizenship and democracy, if we view policing as, you know, a reflection of the democratic process and maybe even like the populace and what they view to be or how they want to criminalize people or certain acts, then the question for me is, what is the incentive for the policing to change? There's obviously there's Brown versus Board, there's the Constitution, and all these ideas that we may have on paper, but obviously within their force and generally how the sentiments are amongst people, if people feel like Black lives don't matter culturally, then no matter what forces we're doing, that institution of policing or that culture of policing that we may see may remain the same. So how do we frame the incentive other than money, which in some cases isn't enough to get them to change how they police? Thank you.
Okay, let me apologize to those of you whose questions we're not going to get. We'll hear from Professor Ifill and then we'll adjourn for refreshments outside.
So I'm going to combine the answers to these two questions about kind of what do you do about the narrative piece, because if we start thinking about policing as a job, which is why I talk about kind of professionalization being really important, we all succumb to the norms of our job if there are consequences for not succumbing to it, right? You publish a certain number of articles, otherwise you're not gonna get tenure. I mean, every job has its thing, and you do the thing if you wanna stay in that job. And that's why I'm emphasizing the accountability piece. The intentions will never work without the accountability. The questions that you want to ask are about the structure, the accountability structure within your police department. You want to know, who do we go to when we have complaints? How do we monitor those complaints, right? Tell us more about the investigation process. Can you make transparent all the information about civil rights complaints that have been filed against officers in this precinct? We need to know who, you know, has there been discipline? Like, you want to know what are the procedures? And this is, you know, we sued the NYPD and NYCHA about these trespass arrests in public housing, right? And, you know, we spent the better part of a year, like, it's like down to the patrol guy, like that sentence. I mean, it's like that minute, because your intentions are just your intentions, right? As it would be in any workplace. And so until you create, particularly a workplace like policing or the military, where you would think that having structures and accountabilities like baked into the pie, right? That's why it's so alarming to see kind of what happens, right? So the questions that we have, the incentives that we create are about money, but they're also about accountability. If people don't get punished, if you don't get fired, if you don't know that you're going to get fired, right? If you make up that story about that person resisting arrest, right? If you have three arrests on your sheet within 2 years that has what Commissioner Bratton calls the package, right? Resisting arrest, disturbing the peace, and whatever is the other bogus one that, you know, they get when you know something's wrong when you see the package, right? I mean, something has to happen. So that's why this is what I meant when I was talking about why the training is not enough. We need to see the accountability happening not only at the macro level but at the micro level. And I'm saying the money is the way of demanding the accountability, because essentially what you're saying is the federal government is, I'd love to give you this $1 million in this grant, police department of thus and such, but I'm still waiting on this information about how many people were, you know, what happened after these complaints were filed and how were they resolved, and creating a structure. If you have a certain number of civil rights complaints, why are you getting money? You know, so that's what has to be, that's where those two are weaved in together. Now, there's a human element to it. By all means, you should be appealing to you know, officers who say and command structures who say they're open to engaging with the community, because there's no question that there's a touch that's happening there and there needs to be trust. But trust is not going to get built in the community unless the community sees accountability, unless people see that something happens to people, officers, who don't follow the training, who don't follow the rules. There's not going to be trust. It's just going to be words. So that's, you know, those, the inquiries I would have would be about that. On the strategic piece, you know, that's really important. So people ask all the time, you know, LDF is known for all these Supreme Court cases. I'm not particularly interested in bringing a case before this Supreme Court at this moment, right? So, I mean, you know, that's real, right? Because you're going to create law that's going to affect millions of people's lives. So, but what you should be doing is figuring out where you can make inroads, right? That's why I talked about the first case on the road to Brown, the University of Maryland case, was filed in one municipal court in Baltimore City. It wasn't even a federal court case. So part of our job is to think about where we can experiment, you know, in places where we think the courts are amenable, right? So that you can begin to create some good law and create some good experiences that you can then work your way up, and trust that, as always happens, courts change. And, you know, Supreme Court will change too. Right? It's you know, Chief Justice Vincent has a heart attack in between the oral arguments in Brown, and that's how Earl Warren becomes the Chief Justice, right? And he has a certain kind of political, you know, power and sensibility and so forth, notwithstanding his role in the internment, at least around Brown, right? So I'm just saying, but your job is not to be focused on that, but to be figuring out what have you workshopped, right, that will be ready for that moment. So yes, we feel like we have to be very strategic. And because so many of the federal courts are really, you know, quite hostile to civil rights claims, or just simply are hardwired not to believe in discrimination, which is what we're seeing more and more. And that is, you know, that's, again, a subject for another talk, where that's the only way I can describe it. It's kind of a hardwiring to believe that discrimination doesn't happen. That some of it is because the stigma of racism now is an actual stigma, right? Which is good. But the other part of it is just kind of the refusal to believe. I mean, some of you may remember the case from the 11th Circuit Court of Appeals three years ago, when a supervisor called, this was Tyson Foods, Ash versus Tyson Foods. And the supervisors out of Alabama, and the white supervisor called the African-American man, boy. And the court said, you know, we don't really think that's a term of racial significance. And we had to literally file an amicus brief with, like, Andy Young and, you know, Charles Sherrod, all these civil rights leaders saying, yeah, it is, here's all the examples. You know what I mean? Like, so it gets that ridiculous, where there's such a desire to erase this, you know, to just erase it. That's why the, you know, the videos of these police officers become so important, because there is this desire to just make it go away. Right? What did Chief Justice Roberts say? The only way to stop racial discrimination is to stop discriminating based on race. Well, there you go. So we do have to be strategic, because that's the obstacle those are the obstacles that we're facing.
So we've had an extraordinary combination of
Thank you all for coming, and please join us for refreshment in the hall.